It's got like almost this let me tell you about the day I died kind of vibe to it.
Way he's doing it right at the very end, it's almost like that shallow breathing when you're sort of about to. But I mean, it's worth it alone for the line, Killer Priest was born in a pillar of yeast. I mean, you don't hear that every day.
Nope. Nope. Hello, viewers and listeners, and welcome back to another edition of the Audiophiles. My name's Andy. The fellow over there is John. John, let's just cut to the chase, man. What do you got for me?
As they say on Monty Python's Flying Circus, and now for something completely different. I've got a track for you. Well, actually, it's two songs, but they were made to segue into each other. And if you listen very carefully, you may be able to spot the join. So the band is John Spencer Blues Explosion.
Okay.
Blues is number one, baby. Blues is number one. And the track tracks is Greyhound Remix Parts 1 and 2.
Okay. Are they responsible for the remix, or you? On the other side, I suppose I will.
Yeah, the link I've sent you, it's all joined into one track.
Okay, okay, good. Well, that's convenient. All right, well, let me hop aboard this Greyhound and give this thing a listen. I need to experience that again. When that extra dimension of sound just entered the room. Yeah. I mean, I was already digging kind of like this new take on like this, like driving Delta blues kind of sound. And then bam, you get hit with that. Let's just go back to here and kick it off. 2 minutes into this, if this gives me no vocals at all, I'm totally fine with that. I'm sure John knows I'm totally fine with that, especially given how awesome this sounds and how they just keep building on it. And we've talked about this in previous songs where you just take a groove and then you just build on it and you play with the dynamics. And it's this one thing here, but then it's this another thing here. But throughout it all, there's this constant. And oh, I love that sound. And they're doing some really like that. Oh, that as simple as that is, it just every time it comes back around, I find myself like anticipating it. This is lovely.
Destination was to seek life. I mean, stars were so low, they appeared as streetlights. I was shown a crucifixion by two Egyptians with war in heaven. I saw Christ with a Mac 11, so I joined his army and prepared for Armageddon. Taking me into the mental orgasms, ejaculating, stimulating, relating to life, incubating, rotating around light beams. From a light beam, I was formed in a white dream, and then redeemed like powder, out of my maker, into nature, returned the vapor, killer, priest, was born in the pillar of yeast, lost in the miscarriage, the automatic for marriage.
Song reaction, but it was almost like a spiritual experience as well. This was just awesome. The production, the arrangement, the sampling, the mix, like just everything was really cool and very interesting. And it kind of like a good book or a good movie or you know, television series or something. It just had me on the edge of my seat wanting to know what they were going to do next. This was great. Back to John.
Oh, so this is called, this group, John Spencer Blues Explosion. This song should have been called the Andrew Branch Mind Explosion. This was a treat. I loved it, man. So fucking awesome. Kicks off with some really fuzzy, plodding, almost Delta blues kind of groove to it. That instantly captured my attention, and I loved it out of the gate.
Sorry, Andy. I think it's probably, that bit that you heard at the start, that's the original part of the song.
Okay.
That everything else isn't. Yeah. Everything else isn't. Yeah. But that's the original.
Okay, cool. That makes sense because it had a very bluesy feel to it, and a sound that I would have suspected from John Spencer Blues Explosion. But then, right when I'm like, I like this.
Yeah.
I fucking loved it because this huge wall of noise that you don't expect could even fit in it at this point, like washes over you, and it just amplifies an already captivating track very early on. There are then some sustained keynotes on of some variety or another that join the fray, and there's this almost celestial sound to the song, and then this really interesting sound is laid on top at the same part of each progression that almost sounds like some sort of digital phasing wah effect. And I found that really infectious. And then I discovered it to be very present. It's used a lot throughout the song thereafter. And I really thought that was kind of like almost, remember when we were talking about Man Man and you were talking about the keyboard earworm? This was kind of the earworm of this song that gets in your, that gets in your head. And then there's this blazing ass guitar solo that's laid over this, almost industrial blues sounding groove. And it comes like this close to just absolutely making my face spontaneously combust. I could feel the heat radiating off my monitor. It was awesome. And after the end of the lead begins a new motif in the song. And this is where this is where I assume part two makes its introduction.
Yeah, maybe.
Begins around the 4:15 marker or so. This slowed down, almost hip hop beat takes over or becomes like the focal point. With a spoken word style vocals, stating the narrator was buried on the battlefield. There's this like sick bass or synthesized bass work that flutters beneath the beat, before the vocalist begins to expand on his earlier declaration, right? And the words he delivered with a flow, he delivered the words of the flow that's similar to like that drum work that we saw introduced in this second part. It's slowed down, but still very rhythmic and absolutely like dire in nature, with the allusions to modern warfare in what is the Middle East. And at some point claiming to have seen Jesus with a Mach 11, which is just wild. I mean, among all the wild shit that I caught that he was saying this part, that was like the most I opened my eyes there. Then in what I suppose is the next stanza or verse, he references all these words related to like the creation of life, only to end it with an allusion to miscarriage, which is very hefty. And you try to wrap your head around what all of that means. I mean, obviously it sounds to me like, maybe the last thoughts of a man who's died at war overseas, in this foreign land or something like that. It was very, very thought provoking, to say the least. I adored this song, and I'm just going to say, I'm curious, given that it is a remix and you kind of touched on this earlier with saying that only that intro bit was really the truest form of the original song. But I really want to know how much of it was changed and how much of it was true to the original source. I think I've got that answer, but I'd also like to know who's taken responsibility for doing this remixing, both in, and perhaps it's two separate individuals or entities, or it's the same, but, the stylings of the first half are they sound contemporary or of the same time, but of different genres. So I'm wondering, is that the duality of one person or entity's tastes, or is this two people coming from kind of different subworlds of the music industry to collaborate and create this thing anew?
It's two different artists. It's the same song, believe it or not, being reimagined in two different ways. And perhaps because I've listened to it so much like that, but I think that they are supposed to be listened together and they do work, even though they're so disparate. They do work together.
They clearly work together. Clearly work together.
Cool. Excellent. All right. Well, I'll tell you a bit about it then.
Please do.
I'll skirt over John Spencer Blues Explosion, because they're already about 10% of this output in terms of the song. But for those who don't know, John Spencer Blues Explosion, three piece from New York City, formed in 1991. John Spencer, vocals, guitar, and theremin. Judah Bauer, guitar, backing vocals, and harmonica. And Russell Simmons, drums. So they're described as blues, rock and roll, punk, hip hop beats, R&B, garage, alt rock. They've done 9 studio albums, plus loads of other like bootleg albums, reissue compilations. So it's hard to get, you know, do a list of studio albums. There's even more, but 9 proper ones and remix albums as well. So this track, Greyhound, is from their 1994 album, Orange. which is probably a high point in their sort of artistic output.
Okay.
I think it's probably the most consistent album there. They've had some really, I really like this band a lot. They're very interesting. But this album, Orange, it's a howling attack of swagger, spittle, and Elvis sneers. They name check themselves in every song. And it's always with a holler. It's John Spencer Blues Explosion. You know, and when they always talk, they're from
New York
City. You know, right? Yeah, exactly. It's exactly what it's like. And it's great. It really is infectious as well. And there's lots of hurts and, you know, and he does do his fake sort of Elvis persona. And he goes, God damn, stuff like that. And that's sort of, you know, so it's funny, but it's also really endearing as well. And you just get wrapped up in it. So these two tracks were from the Experimental Remixes EP, which came out the following year, 95. And it featured six songs that were remixed and reshaped and reimagined by Uncle Beck, Mike D from the Beastie Boys, Dub Narcotic Sound Systems, and these two tracks. The first one, hang on to your baseball cap, was reshaped and reimagined by Moby. And the second one was by GZA, the genius. And featuring Killer Priest.
Wow.
Wu-Tang.
Yes. Yeah. That's amazing. GZA, the genius. Yeah, that is really, really cool. That, yeah. I mean, both just the, I mean, you've got John Spencer Blues Explosion, you've got
Moby, you know, and, you've got Moby,
and then you've got, you know, the Godfathers of group rap out of New York and Wu-Tang, and it's just fucking awesome.
Yeah,
I love it. It explains so much I'm not a Moby like diehard or anything, but I've enjoyed some of Moby's output. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I've heard scant smatterings of John Spencer Blues Explosion, but I'm behind what they do. Like they play a style of music that I like. And then you add one of my favorite like hip hop artists in Wu-Tang, but GZA and RZA are kind of like, you know, the high end of the totem pole when it comes to Wu-Tang. So it's like, oh my God, this is fucking amazing. So yeah, all of that checks out. An odd, you know, trinity of collaborators here on this, but my God, it was so fucking
really interesting. I mean, you know, Beck and Mike D's one. So honestly, they're a bit of a mess, but they're interesting. So, but the album Orange has got this sort of, what you call it, Ditchwater blues, but what they've tried to do is incorporate hip-hop sort of beats to it, played organically, you know, so it gives it this, you know, very interesting, and they got a lot of shit for that actually, and there are a lot of people complaining about, you know, cultural appropriation, white guys trying to do black guys music, you know, but no one really brings up all the hundreds and hundreds of other white guys who've done it for the last 50, 60 years, you know, start with Elvis and going forwards, you know, so yeah, and whatever.
Not that you and I are the arbiters on this thing, but I would say that if you catch the attention and attract GZA, like you got to have some amount of street cred behind that. If somebody like that wants to be part of your project, if they can respect what you're doing and not be offended or up in arms, then come on. What are we doing here?
Yeah. So the reason I picked this is because it's fucking awesome, but also because it's interesting as well. And something a bit different from people who may be familiar with John Spencer Blues Explosion may not be familiar with this. And it's definitely, so you're getting three for the price of one, really. The first part, I absolutely adore. And you say it starts off with the sort of the looped original guitar, which has got a lovely sort of, you know, rolling swagger to it. And then these synths come in. And as you said, the word celestial is really, and then on top of it, you say that bit, you know, to me, it almost sounds like an alien speaking to you or something like that. It almost sounds conversational. It's so odd, but it worked so well. And then I mean, this probably, you know, we've seen him now, but in 1995, it was a massive shock that that guitar was played by Moby. He was like king of the keyboards, you know. Yeah. I know he's been playing the guitar since he was five or something, and you've seen him on other stuff since, but back in 95, you know, he was the geek with glasses and a keyboard. And this face melting, as you say, guitar solo is just unbelievable. And when this came out, I got it, it just blew my tiny mind that it was Moby. The synths made sense, but the guitars, like, fucking hell.
I know.
Who knew? But I mean, probably the people who were proper fans of Moby knew, but I didn't. And then, as you say, then segues into this, you know, it all drops out and you've got this basic, and it does feel like you're a camera panning a battlefield with the smoke just wafting around and burnt out trees, you know, almost like the trenches and the battlefields of World War One, you know, where it's muddy and the whole piece is brooding and ominous and has a great atmosphere to it. And Killer Priest does what he does and adds this layer of paranoia and despair with this spiritual religious overtones, which he loves so much.
Mm-hmm.
I've got the lyrics. So, such as they are, for part two. So I'll rattle through them because it's quite interesting. And as you say, his flow is really, I mean, it is really good, you know, and he does change it as well. I can't do it like him.
No, please, John, do.
No, for contractual reasons, I'm not allowed. He's, you know, he has he has taken it to court and apparently I'm not allowed. No, so yo, be for real, he says, and then I was buried on the battlefield in this little break. And then I was buried on a battlefield located near Israel. The rest of my platoon was trapped upon a hill. I heard Mega and it sort of breaks and it's yo, be for real. I was buried on a battlefield. I heard mega bombs, firearms, and more alarms and hand grenades, mad rage and evil ways. My destination was to seek life. I mean, the stars were so low they appeared as streetlights. I was shown the crucifixion by two Egyptians. There was war in heaven. I saw Christ with a Mac 11. So I joined his army, prepare for Armageddon, Armageddon, Armageddon. And there's another break, and then he comes back at the end. They told me this, slowly taking me into the mental orgasms, ejaculating, stimulating, relating to life, incubating, rotating around light beams. From a light beam, I was formed in the white dream and then redeemed by powder out of my maker into nature, returned to vapor. Killer Priest was born in a pillar of yeast, lost in the miscarriage, the automatic for marriage. And then it fades.
Yeah, that's... Again, I will say what I said before. It is very thought-provoking to hear all those words just rattled out. And it's got like almost this, let me tell you about the day I died kind of vibe to it.
Way he's doing it right at the very end, it's always got that shallow breathing when you're sort of about to. But I mean, it's worth it alone for the line, Killer Priest was born in a pillar of yeast. I mean, you don't hear that every day.
Nope. Nope.
Yes, quite something. Well, yeah, I'm glad you liked it because it was a bit sort of, you know, out there. But we had all the elements, I think. And hopefully, guys out there, you'll like it as well. At least one of the parts, at least. But which one is up to you? So let us know what you think. Drop some comments if you're familiar with this or if you're not and what your impressions were. We love to engage with you and hear what you have to say. And and if you like this, please hit the like button. Help us with those algorithms so that we can catch that pigeon. If you haven't subscribed, please do. More gems like this coming your way very soon. You don't want to miss out.
Catch them all.
That being said, thanks again so much for watching. Thanks, Andy, for listening, and I'm glad you enjoyed it.
It was literally my pleasure.
Excellent. And we'll see all of you next time. But before we go, we certainly hope you all enjoy the show. And remember, people, no matter who you are, what you do to live, thrive, and survive, there are still some things that makes us all the same. You, me, them, Everybody. Anyway, we'll see you on the next episode of The Audio Files.
Take care, y'all.